And thanks for inviting me to be a part of this. I'm super excited about it. I'm going to go ahead and just share my screen. Thank you for everybody who's joined today. I really appreciate you being here, and hopefully we'll make this content that will be valuable for you. So take me just a second to get this. All right. Okay, so now you should be able to see that Y stretch healthy lifestyle presentation. And I am assuming that everybody on this call is participating in the March into May. I am a team captain this year. I'm super excited. I have built-in personal trainers called my dogs. They are living the life and get walked 3 times a day, whether I want to do it or not. So that is helpful for me with my steps, but not everybody has that. But I do know the value of stretching, and as Sadie mentioned, it really does make a difference, especially if you're starting to increase your walking or any exercise. But I think walking is one of those that we think, oh, I'm just going to go out and walk. It's no big deal. I don't need to warm up. I don't need to cool down. I don't need to stretch. And the opposite, right? We really do need to do these things. So as Sadie mentions, this is going to be quick. I'm going to talk fast because I know we're all working. And I want to make this content valuable to you. Real quick, I'm a health educator with Aging and Adult Services, the health promotion team. Super excited. I've been here since May of 2019. I do love working with people who want to use exercise to increase independence and quality of life and longevity. That's why I'm a perfect fit for working with the older adults and younger adults who understand that exercise spans more than just athletic abilities. I've lived in Utah since 2008, and I do CrossFit. And I mentioned that I kind of take the stigma off of it a little bit. I really enjoy it. I also walk a ton, as I mentioned, with my dogs. So I do enjoy walking, and it's a good thing. What I don't enjoy is stretching. You know, truth be told, stretching has always been something that I have struggled with. And I think that's because people have always told me, you want to be flexible. And the reality is I have a very muscular body, and I have a very tight body, and it's genetic. You can see my dad, and you're like, oh yeah, you guys are related. And he was very, very tight. His body was very, very tight. And so, you know, you need to stretch, you need to be flexible. And I never really valued flexibility until it was put in a few different terms. And that's what I'm kind of approach this as today, is we don't stretch simply to be flexible. We stretch to increase and maintain our mobility. And that's super important, right? Our ability to move our bodies. That's what it's all about. If you want to be a yogi and you want to be flexible and you want to be able to hold your head up above your leg up above your head, that's great. And that is a great goal to have. But that's not the only thing that comes with flexibility. We also want mobility. We want to be able to move our bodies around. And so I want to talk about what mobility is. And mobility is a combination of strength and flexibility. If you can see the slides, I know some of you might be listening on your phones, but if you can see the slides, you can see that I have a slide of the walking gait. And the reason I chose a walking gait is because, you know, March into May, talking about walking, but also because I don't know if you've ever really thought about the strength and flexibility that is involved in our walking gait. To move our leg forward in the first phases of walking, we have to have strength in our quadriceps, that's the front of our thighs, to pull our leg forward. And not to be gruesome or graphic, but if you just were holding a leg, it's heavy. Legs aren't like super light. You know, we don't have a sense of how heavy our body is. Yes, we step on the scale and we do that thing, but I'm talking about a head weighs a certain amount, an arm weighs a certain amount, and it's really hard to get a sense of that when you're attached to your body. But when we're swinging our leg forward, we need to have muscle to be able to do that. But not only do we need to have the muscle to swing the leg forward, the hamstring, the back of the thigh, and the glute, that's your butt, need to be flexible enough to move with that forward motion. If you have really tight glutes or really tight hamstring, that's the back of the thigh, your quadricep, no matter how strong it is going to struggle to get the range that one needs to have a proper walking gait. And that's the same thing that happens when, if you look at the letter C and D and even E phases of the walking gait, now our hamstrings need to be strong enough to pull our leg back, but also that quadricep, and even more so in the hip flexor need to be flexible enough to allow that hamstring to do its job. So I stretch to facilitate my strength. You know, I'm all about strength. Strength has done a lot for me in my life. I'm a very small female, and being strong has helped me feel that I can handle most situations. Flexibility hasn't done a ton for me, but it sure does help my mobility. So I'm kind of coming at that stretching from a little bit different angle. If you're kind of struggling with why stretch, it's to facilitate that strength. If you want to have strong muscles, you also need to have flexible muscles, or you cannot be mobile, or mobility is greatly affected. So why do we want to value our mobility? Well, mobility means you're playing a sport. It means you're dancing, you're walking. People think of mobility as getting around, but it's more than that. It's getting onto the ground and back up. I don't know if any of you have been on the ground lately, but if you haven't, you should get down on the ground, because if you find yourself there on accident, you want to be able to get back up regardless, right? Bending down and picking something up off the ground, your kid, your dog, a package, right? Getting in and out of your car takes an incredible amount of mobility. You know, think about it. You have to lift your leg up into the car. You have to, you know, twist your rear end into the car, twist your torso back in and pull that trail leg. So a lot of strength, a lot of flexibility involved in getting in and out of your car, going up and down stairs, grocery shopping, dressing yourself, and bathing. And I put these in this order on purpose to go from mobility isn't just about being an athlete. It's also about bathing yourself. It's about being able to go to the bathroom. So mobility is something that you really should value. And if you don't right now, maybe start thinking about it a little bit differently so that you can find reasons to value your mobility. And if you value your mobility, your ability to move your body, you will in turn value stretching. You will start to value flexibility, and you'll also value strength. All important. Another thing that really made a kind of light bulb go off for me is I stretch in order to decrease injury. And this again, flexibility really does, being flexible. And when I say being flexible, again, I don't mean that extreme flexibility. I don't mean being able to do the lateral splits or the splits where your legs are out in front of you necessarily. I don't mean that you're a contortionist. Flexibility to me means that you have ample range of motion around a joint. And again, that takes that flexibility in the muscle, the ability for that muscle to stretch when it's asked to by the opposing muscle group. And we stretch to decrease injury. And this really is a big, big reason. And again, for all you March into May people, if you want to keep marching into June and July and August and for the rest of your life, we don't want to get injured, or we want to minimize our injuries. So stretching, especially after exercise, and we're going to talk about stretching and when we stretch and what kind of stretches and all that kind of stuff. But stretching, especially after exercise, helps keep the muscles healthy and flexible. So again, flexibility is part of a healthy muscle. For that muscle to be able to move through a range of motion without feeling that it is it far, you know, that it can't go as far as you want it to go. Stretching helps to increase blood flow through the muscle. And, you know, we need the blood. Blood is great. It decreases metabolic waste, so that blood flow takes out all the toxins and everything else that is in your body just naturally and from exercise. It increases oxygen, which we all know our bodies need oxygen. Every part of them need oxygen. And it increases nutrients to the muscles. So that stretching does all of those things. It's not just, hey, I want to be flexible, so I'm going to stretch. It's, hey, I want to have healthy muscles because that helps decrease my, you know, ability or my predisposition, I suppose, to injury. So I put a picture of a sprinter here. And, you know, sprinters, they move very quickly and it's very ballistic. And you can imagine what muscles have to go through to facilitate such a ballistic experience as a sprint. They have to lengthen and shorten very, very quickly. And a lot of times this is where we find that we're injured. And no, we're not all sprinters like this person, but we do get up off the couch quickly sometimes. Or maybe for those of you who still have kids, you might have to run after your child. And you're not, you didn't warm up, you didn't think about it. They just started running towards the street and you take off after them. A healthy muscle, a muscle that has flexibility to it and strength to it, has all those toxins out of it and has good oxygen flow, is going to be way more able to handle that motion without being injured. And if you do get injured, it's much less. Speaking mainly to like older adults, which of course are my people, I think of things like getting off balance. I don't know if any of you have gotten off balance or fallen recently. I do. I fall. I'm a tripper. That's who I am. When we fall, our body tries to right it, right? We try to keep ourselves on balance. And a lot of times we do that through muscle motion. And the muscle motion is very quick. And that a lot of times when people fall, yes, they get hurt by the impact of falling. They also hurt the back of their shoulder from jerking themselves, trying not to fall. And again, that healthy muscle is going to be able to withstand that impact, if you will, much better, much better. So there's some reasons, some new reasons for you to stretch. Mobility and decreased injury. Those are great reasons. Now let's talk about types of stretching. And again, I'm kind of rushing through this because I want to make sure we have ample time to talk about different stretches. So types of stretching, and you know, when I was first into fitness, I only knew about static stretching. Dynamic stretching was not something that was talked about. I'm sure it was talked about with athletes, but I was just a person in a gym being a trainer. And it wasn't until probably the late 90s, maybe early 2000s, that I started hearing about dynamic stretching as a type of stretching. I think a lot of you are familiar with the static stretching, but so I'm going to talk about that dynamic stretching first. Dynamic stretching is also often, excuse me, used with athletes. If you watch football, you know, I watch professional football, but it didn't really matter, any kind of football, any kind of sport, tennis, basketball, if you have the opportunity to watch the athletes warming up, they're usually doing different running drills where they're moving their bodies quickly in a lateral motion or a forward motion, and some it's perceived, okay, they're warming up, they're getting their blood flowing. And they are, but they're also doing dynamic stretches, which again are usually used as part of a warm-up. They're not used as part of a cool down. And it's more rapid, dynamic, or ballistic even. Although ballistic is a little harsh of a word to be used for a warm-up. So I like to say dynamic movement through a range of motion. So for example, if I were going to do a workout that had walking or running, even if it were something like tennis, which doesn't necessarily have walking or running, but it does have movement, I would do these types of exercises, these types of warm-up or dynamic stretches. So one, and many of you have heard these, we all hate these, right? High knees. That's where you're just lifting your knees up as high as you can go. I'm gonna change my camera real quick. So high knee can simply be this, where you're just lifting your knee up. It doesn't have to be rapid. It can be slower, as opposed to, you know, a very high intensity pulling up of the knees. And of course, we wouldn't want to do that at the high intensity unless we were warm, right? We want to warm up first, but part of a warm up might be those high knees. It might be butt kickers, where you're pulling your heel to your rear end. And you're trying to, you know, that's why they call them butt kickers. You're trying to kind of kick yourself in the butt. And what those butt kickers are doing are stimulating the hamstrings and the quadriceps both. Right? The hamstrings are contracting and releasing quickly to bring the heel up to the rear end. And the quadricep has to stretch to allow that heel to come up to your rear end. And that's where having a healthy, flexible quadricep is going to be a great advantage, because you're going to get a good amount of movement at your knee, and you're not going to put a lot of pressure on your knee joint because your hamstring's having to fight against this super tight quadricep. Hopefully that makes sense to you. There are other dynamic stretches that you might do, karaoke, if you, you know, or side steps, those side steps where you twist, put one foot in front of the other, even ring rows or push-ups, scapular push-up, something along those lines. Again, if push-ups are really hard for you, does that make sense to do that as part of a warm-up? No. So it gets to be very personal, but it's basically just taking the muscle through a range of motion in somewhat of a dynamic fashion. And again, this is something that you would use before you walk. So before you go out for your walk, you're doing some high knees, you're doing some butt kickers, maybe you're doing a few twists in your torso, just to say, hey, body, we're about to get moving. And this would be coupled with a warm-up. Warm-up's so important. I could give a whole talk just on warm-ups. Well, that's not what today's about, so I'm going to skip that. Static stretches. These are the ones that I think more people are familiar with, and these are the ones that really should be done after your workout, or after a warm-up. Okay, so dynamic stretches are done during a warm-up as preparation for cardiovascular or muscular exercise. And static stretches can be done, but only after your body is warm. So again, you can warm up and just do static stretches. But what you don't want to do is warm up, do static stretches, and then do exercise or muscular exercise. You want to save those static stretches for after your walk. And these are the ones, you know, again, we hold the stretch for 10 to 60 seconds. If you're like me, it's like torture holding it for 30 seconds. The older we get, the longer we need to hold our stretches. And this is part of the reason that I always was like, well, forget it. I don't want to do stretches. I'd rather do 10 more minutes of cardio, or I'd rather do more of my strength training. And what I was doing was shooting myself in the foot, because the static stretches take the muscle. So after you go on a walk, and Sadie, this is probably what you're experiencing, we go on a walk and our muscles, they go through range of motion, but they get really tight because they're having to work. And then we walk our 10 minutes or 20 minutes or hour or whatever you're walking. And then we come back to our home or wherever we are. And we usually either just stand or sit afterwards. And so we have those muscles that are really tight, and they just kind of sit there tight. And then so when you go to do exercise again, or you go to walk, they say, hey, what's going on? I'm super tight. And that's when moving your leg forward, maybe you have a pain in your back or a pain in your hamstring, because that hamstring is still really tight from your exercise. So when you stretch, it takes that tight muscle and brings it back to that blood flow and nutrients back to that longer relaxed position. And that's where we want our muscles to be the vast majority of the time, is in that longer, more of a relaxed position, because that's going to allow us to move our bodies, be mobile, move through range of motion without, again, getting injured. So the static stretches are also incredibly important. Super, super, super important. So let's talk about the best stretches to do after walking and running. And I know many of you are at work and, you know, you're not going to do these stretches, and I get it. No big deal. I am going to show them to as best I can. I have pictures as well. And most of you are going to be familiar with these stretches. There's nothing new here. But after you walk and you run, you know, what you want to think about with stretching is, what muscles did I just use? muscles. And the reality is when we walk or we run, we're using all our muscles, but some more than others, right? So when you're walking or running, you're not using your biceps a ton, you're not using your triceps a ton. Your lats are getting a little bit of motion, chest, but they're not really getting a ton, but our torso is getting more, our hips are getting a lot, and our legs are getting a lot. So I am gonna be talking about stretches that really are kind of from the torso, mid-torso down. Doesn't mean the upper body doesn't need to be stretched, it does, but here are the ones that really are gonna make a difference and make you feel better after your stretches. So just to kind of tell you what we're gonna do, we'll do the lower leg, that's from the knee down. We'll do the front of the upper leg, we'll do the back of the upper leg, and we'll do the side of the hip. And I failed to include inner thigh, but I'll talk about that. And then we'll also talk about the side body and the torso in general. All right, so let's first talk about our lower leg. And this is one that's really, really important. Hopefully none of you will experience inflamed Achilles tendons or shin splints after walking. But it's very common because people haven't put their lower legs through a workout and they decide I'm going to go walk 2 miles and their legs are like, hey, what are you doing to us? And usually they go on that 2 mile walk without a warm up. So you can see in this top left hand corner, I have a picture of a person who is stretching the front of their shin, and that muscle is called the anterior tibialis. Excuse me. When we walk, the reason that we don't trip all the time is because we are lifting our toes up, and that's called dorsiflexion, taking our toes and lifting them up, flexing at our ankle. That's what keeps you from tripping over the uneven sidewalks. Or the carpet in your house. Have you ever done that where you just kind of stumble over nothing? Usually that's because you're not clearing the ground with your foot. And you can see this person has their ankles in a flex position, I suppose. We'll call that dorsiflexion, right? They're pointing their toes and they're sitting down on their back, on their heel. And for some of us, this isn't doable because of that extreme flexion at the knee. Yeah, some of you are like, yeah, my knees aren't going to do that. But if your knees will do that, great. Personally, this stretch doesn't work great for me, but it is a great stretch. The other way that you can stretch the front of your shin is put your toe on the ground and then just kind of ease into that stretch on the front of the ankle. Right, so you can do it right now when you're standing. You can just put your toe back and open that angle at the ankle. Also, another way to do it is manipulation. Right, get a tennis ball, your thumbs, a stick, if you know what the stick is, and roll it down the front of your thighs, a foam roller, anything to get that muscle and just say, hey, you can relax now. We're done walking. I want you to be nice and long and lean and have the ability to contract when I need you to. So I'm going to stretch you out. So the front of the leg, a lot of times that manipulation is a great way to do it. The back of the leg, the calf. And this is where people really tend to have the problems after walking and running. Is the back of the lower leg. So if I have a couple of pictures here, one, the person is standing and their foot is up against the wall and they're leaning forward, and that's going to stretch the back of the calf. And this is something again that you can do. I'm going to just change my screen here a little bit. So you can see the feet, might not be able to see my head, but simply just stepping back and placing your heel on the ground. That's going to stretch your hamstring, your calf. And most of you can feel that if you were to do this stretch right down here in the lower leg. Another way to stretch your calf, if you're sitting at your chair, is to extend at your knee. So straighten your leg out in front of you and flex at your ankle. So press your heel away from you. That is also stretching the calf. And one of the reasons our calves get tight is because we run and walk and do other things, but also because we wear high heels. Right? And it's any heel. It can be a 1-inch heel. Nobody regardless of your fashion sense, is free from maybe wearing a heeled shoe. But heels do a lot of damage to our calves. So after you have a day of wearing heels, you should stretch your calves just like you would after a workout. And then I have a picture here on the bottom left-hand side of a person doing a down dog. And this is a yoga pose. I'm not a big yoga girl. I don't love yoga, as you can imagine, because it's all stretching, right? But the down dog is a wonderful stretch. I recommend it to anybody who is walking or running, because look at how much this person is stretching. Their hamstrings, their calves, their lats from having the arms overhead, the chest. I mean, everything's being stretched here. It's a wonderful, wonderful stretch. It's kind of like a full body stretch that one can do after any sort of activity. So if you don't know how to do a down dog, that's worth going to yoga for and exploring it. The lower leg, front and back of the lower leg, super important after you walk. Next, we're going to talk about the upper thigh. So we got the front and the back of the upper thigh. That's what these pictures are showing. And so we have person over here on the left-hand side who's doing a standing quadricep stretch. And they are have a pretty severe bend at the knee. So again, those of you who can't flex at the knee, this one's going to be a tough one, but I have a solution for you. And I think we've all seen this one. I have a hard time doing this one because I don't have, again, that great flexibility in my quadricep. So I kind of have to throw my leg up behind me. And that can, you know, get into my low back. There's all sorts of things about it. But more often than not, I think this stretch does work. And you can see that it just opens up the front of the hip and the hip area all the way down to the knee, which is going to be your quadricep. The person to the right that's up on the top has a similar position, but is in a kneeling position. So that one is also a great one to do. This person started in a kneeling position and then put one leg forward and then reached back for the foot behind them. This is a hard position to get into. I struggle with this one, but it is a wonderful stretch. This person is getting a stretch from pretty much mid torso all the way through the front of the hip, all the way through the front of the upper leg. So if you're able to get into that position, that's great. If you're like me and all of those are troublesome for you, then there is the standing lunge. And this is one where, again, if you can and you can stand up, just try to adjust my screen so you can kind of see my feet, might not be able to see my head. I'm gonna start up in your side view, feet together. I'm gonna take a step back and be a small step. It can also be a really large step, but for those of you who don't necessarily have great balance, make sure your feet are on two railroad tracks rather than just one. And then you're gonna push your hips forward. And again, we're opening up the line on this, the leg that's in the back. We're opening the line of that hip so we can stretch all the way from below our ribs down to our knee. Again, this is one that you can get way down into a runner's lunge if you were so inclined. So for me, that is a stretch that I find takes care of the front of my hip and my quadricep, the front of my thigh, as opposed to the standing quadricep, which I can't do right now because I'm not warm anyway. So that is another way to stretch your quadricep. Super important to do after running. As I talked about with the gait, right? That quadricep has a lot to do with it. Next, let's talk about the hamstring and glutes. So a lot pictures here because it's very personal what works for you stretching. If you look at the top picture in the middle, this person is stretching their hamstring on what looks to be a bed, which is wonderful, right? The heel isn't on something super hard, and it's a pretty simple, you know, leg is up on the bed, leaning forward. So this is one that you can do, you know, if you have a desk or something, lift that leg up and lean forward. You can do that on a chair, on your bed, on your couch, right? All sorts of things. Notice that the person in the picture is kind of leaning forward. I don't love the picture because it almost looks like their back is rounded, and you want to stay away from rounding your back. You really want a nice flat back or relatively flat back to avoid any sort of problems with the lumbar area of your spine and herniated discs in that lumbar area and even in the thoracic area. So you're wanting to really hinge at the hips to get the hamstring. If you look at the bottom right hand picture, this person's laying on the ground with something around their leg, legs up in the air. Notice how their heel is pressed up towards the ceiling. Once again, stretching the back of the upper leg, but also stretching the calf. So this is a great stretch for those of you who don't have a lot of patience for stretching. A lot of times the name of the game is doing one stretch that does multiple things. There you go. The other pictures that we have here, the picture on the far right hand side on the top is a forward fold. This person's just sitting down as opposed to standing up, but it's the same thing, relatively flat back. Personally, I'd like to see even a flatter back on that person, but not bad. Not gonna fault them for that. Then the other three on the left-hand side, the top, the bottom left, and the one in the middle on the bottom, all are ways to stretch your piriformis or glute muscles. And this is one where you put your foot to your knee. The bottom middle picture, the person's laying on their back, foot is to their knee, taking the other leg off of the ground. I personally love the one on the bottom left-hand side. Again, this is one that you can do in your office, right, with your chair. I'm gonna put my chair over. I'm sitting in a chair. Here, I can put my foot on my knee and lean forward. That's basically what that person's doing. I'm doing the same thing as a person who's laying on their back with their foot on their knee, right? Flexing my foot, bringing my foot to my knee, and leaning forward. And that's going to be a great stretch for all those muscles that are inside of your hip. They get so upset during walking and running. And then the top left picture is a seated twist. Very simple exercise. Some of us are not going to be able to get that deep into the twist like this person is, but it doesn't matter. Even a small twist is great. And the great thing about that twist is not only is the piriformis getting stretched, but also the IT band and the torso. So again, getting a lot done with one stretch. I mentioned the IT band. I do have a picture here on the far right-hand side. The IT band is a muscle and a tendon that runs from the lateral part of the knee all the way up, becomes your glute medius, which is a muscle on the lateral side of the hip. And the IT band gets very irritated, especially with lots of walking. So for those of you who have knee pain or hip pain after walking, do the IT band stretch. The good news, IT band stretch is pretty simple. You can put your foot up on your knee like I just did, or you can cross one leg over the other and then lean away from the front leg. The front leg is crossed over, you're leaning towards your back foot. It doesn't really matter, but basically opening up the side body. I like that seated position a lot, putting the foot on the knee to stretch that IT band, but you can see the person on the left-hand side, they're just standing and kind of doing a half moon position. You don't have to put your arm up. The person in the middle is doing, is that a reverse triangle? I don't know. It kind of is, but either way, they have their feet together and bending the right knee and then twisting towards the left. And that's going to, again, get up into that hip area, kind of stretch that glute medius, which again becomes that IT band. Super important. The IT band should be on the top of your list if you're doing a lot of walking or running. If you are a star team member on the march into May, this should be in your repertoire for sure. Super, super important. And then just a simple side stretch, you know, so this person is definitely stretching the side of their hip, right? You can see that if you can imagine that their IT band starts with a light blue, the dark comes together on their outfit and goes down to the side of the knee. This is stretching all the side of the body, the ribs, all the musculature that was used while you were walking and moving your torso around. So don't forget the simple side bend. That can hit a lot of muscles. And again, it's a very comprehensive stretch and it's relatively easy to do. If you get off balance pretty easily, then make sure that you hold on to something while you're doing that. So just to wrap up, for stretching tips, only perform those static stretches after your warm up or after exercise and a cool down, not before exercise. That's not when we're doing the static stretches. We want to hold stretches, but not bounce. Hold the stretch, but we're not bouncing in those stretches. We don't want pain with our stretches. Discomfort, maybe, right? But not pain. Discomfort's one thing, pain is quite another. So you can overstretch, you can injure yourself overstretching. Don't do it, not worth it. You want to stretch all sides of your body. You want to stretch the right side and the left side, and the front side and the back side, and the lateral side and the medial side, right? And that's what I was going to say is the inner thigh. So straddle stretches. Remember straddle stretches? We'd sit on the floor and take our legs apart and kind of lean forward. That's a great way to stretch your inner thigh. So are twists. So if you're going to stretch your IT bands, also want to stretch that inner thigh. Sorry, I forgot that one. Don't skip your stretching routine in order to do more cardio or strength. I should say strength exercises there. Stretching is legit. It absolutely is worth the 10 minutes or 5 minutes that you're going to put towards it, depending on how long you worked out. The extra 5 or 10 minutes of strength or cardio is not going to serve you more, and definitely not in the long run. It doesn't serve your longevity to skip stretching. And consider what muscles you use during your exercise to help you determine what muscles you need to stretch. You're doing an upper body volleyball, you want to work your upper strength. Body. If you're playing tennis, you definitely want to work. When you're running, obviously your lower body, really something like tennis, your whole body is used. But something like walking, again, you don't need to be as preoccupied with stretching your shoulders or your biceps or triceps like you might if you have been doing push-ups or pull-ups or something along those lines. So, you know, wow, I just walked. I know I work my legs a lot. I know I work my hips a lot. I need to stretch that area. And of course, if you notice the stretches that I showed you today, were all basically torso and down. So anyway, I know that was a ton of information and that we didn't really stretch, but the more I thought about it, I just didn't think it was going to be majorly conducive for many of us. Thank you for being here. I would love to answer some questions. I saw one at least come through, and I did put my email up there. If any of you are needing to get in touch with me, please feel free. We all work together. I'm always happy to answer questions if you have them. So I will answer any questions or listen to any comments that anybody might have. I'm going to stop sharing here. Let's see here. Who do I got in the chat? What happens to the IT band if you have had a knee replacement? It's a good question. I am now. That's a good question for your physical therapist. I don't want to get out of my scope of practice and even guess on that one, because the knee replacements are awesome, but they are tricky. It's like a hip replacement. And so most likely you had that knee replacement, you had a physical therapist ask them what their thoughts are about the stretching for the IT band, because if they're a good physical therapist, they will know, because they know that with those new knees, you're going to be walking around and that you're going to need to stretch that IT band. Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily put your foot on your knee. You know what I mean? I wouldn't do that stretch. I think the side stretch you're probably a little safer on, but I wouldn't do the other one. Okay, let's see. Stretching is hard for me. Is it okay for me? So this next question is private, so I don't necessarily want to read it out loud, but basically, is it okay to stretch then? I don't know if what this person's asking is it okay to kind of stretch throughout the day? And the main thing is you want to make sure that you're not stretching on cold muscles. So if you've been sitting for an hour watching a show on TV, don't stand up and decide you're going to do static stretches then. Walk around for 5 minutes before you do it. But if you're moving around, which I'm getting the sense from this that the person is moving around on a pretty regular basis, then yeah, it is okay. As long as you got some blood pumping in your body, and it's okay to interlace stretching throughout your day. Absolutely. Just make sure that you're warm, right? Okay. Can't put the foot up on the knee anyway. That's a hard one, foot on the knee. I have a class where that's something we practice because it is not easy to do. And then we have stretching after hernia surgery. Oof, what's recommended? Not leaning back, right? Slow and steady. I can't give you a specific, that's outside my scope. That would be a great conversation to have with your PT. Again, you notice I don't say talk to your healthcare provider. Talk to a physical therapist. They're going to know more about that. But I would say anybody who's had surgery, the name of the game is slow and steady. You're not doing anything super fast. You're not holding. You're not doing ballistics. It's you're easing into your stretching routine. Stretches for the lower back. You know, I didn't really, twists are really good for the lower back. So this person's asking about lower back stretches. So the one where you sit and you twist, that's a great one for low back. Hamstring stretches are great for your lower back. The thing is, a lot of times when you're tight in your lower back, it's not your low back that's tight. It's your glutes or it's your hamstrings. A lot of times it's your hamstrings. So stretching those hamstrings is going to be definitely part of what you're going to do to alleviate the tightness of your low back. Also, a great way to stretch your low back is to strengthen your abdominals. Make your abdominals fight with that low back so your low back can't be tight all the time. But forward folds, that's going to be another one, which I would call a hamstring stretch, but that will stretch your lower back. Easy does it. Easy does it. No pain. No pain. And again, is it okay to stretch after hernia surgery? I have no idea. Ask somebody who can give you a definite answer. I don't even want to tell you something and then find that you injure yourself, then I'd feel awful. So I know that after most surgeries, we do want to move our body, but we want to be thoughtful about it. So that's why I'd ask your physical therapist about it. I know it's 12:46. This is a 45-minute conversation. Thank you for all the comments and questions. If you have further comments or questions, please email me. You can always get my information from Sadie. And good luck with March into May. I'm sure you all are going to do wonderful. It's just about moving your body, keeping everything mobile. And thanks for your attention today. I appreciate it. And Sadie, thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. That was wonderful. And we have recorded this workshop, so we'll be putting that on our YouTube channel too. So if people want to watch it while they stretch, maybe get your March into May team to do it together. That would be fantastic.
Thanks, Sadie.
Thank you.